15, we're spending on, pitch on that. CPCs, one of the things I said, you want to work that back, we can understand going forward what the counties are going to look like in the future. Our present population, the bands of aging, we will be actually, you know, talk to later on services, but I actually, presentation she did at another place, we started getting into thinking about the impact and what it means if this county is aging more rapidly than other places. It's not a bad thing, it's a good thing, but it has impact on local services and revenue, which is our taxes, when the income is high, may be impacted. And then looking for DPC, they're trying to get as best we can handle on, from a school system standpoint, the number of growth that we're going to see, because that's a big expenditure. So you've got potential revenue, potential expenditures, overview of Dr. Flynn's giving us the broader picture on that. And then Phyllis is going to talk to us about citizen services, and we asked her, she might be here a little earlier, so she could hear the other information and reflect on that. Because that was, I thought, when you came to our work, that was a, you were great, it was a really interesting meeting, and it got me thinking about things I hadn't thought about in context. And I think, if I remember, you said no one had asked that question, and it's a question we all need to sort of look at, because it puts a fence around, not a fence, but at least it puts, if not constraints, at least dollars.
Thank you.
The change, and Beverly is not going to come and talk to us, as a conflict and other issues we talked about relative to the budget. They asked Holly to sort of give us some reference relative to what the school board is, or school system is asking for, relative to where we are, relative to the past, relative to the impacts. If not, we don't say anything relative to where we're spending money in the county per se, we just say, here's what you've got to spend. But, and I will probably push back, we're not looking for incredible detail, but we're looking for context. So it's been nice to have, but we'll deal with it in another perspective. So with that, Holly, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Steve. I only go very quickly, because I cannot speak for the school system about their budget, so I only go to touch on the funding side, and based on the super school superintendent's request. And just to clarify, for this group here, the school system's request is not official until get plan, get the board's report review. So that's not the board's official request, it's that the only information we have as of now is the superintendent's proposal. And based on that, the school system was asking $62 million more money, and their expectation for the county's contribution is $595.9 million, which is $51.7 million increase, or 9.5%. And there are expectation at that point for the state aid increase is about $9.5 million. And we actually just got the governor's proposed budget, and we're still verifying the information from, with the school system. Sounds like the state aid is slightly better, I think it's about $1.1 million higher on that, we're still validating the number, but that's a piece of good news. Regarding the expectation from the county, the $51.8 million, but anyway, that's a number threw out there. So just to put the discussion in context, I want to show you, what does that mean? So how much is the $51.8 million? Because for us, normally anything beyond $1 million is very hard to understand, so I try to put in context to help us understand. You know, there's a so-called maintenance effort requirement, that's the state law saying every local governments are required to provide funding to local school system based on, at the minimum level, that's driven by student enrollment growth. So based on state formula, and based on latest state student enrollment number, the maintenance effort requirement for the county contribution to the school system is $10.87 million. This number just come up a couple of days ago, based on official student enrollment data. So what the school superintendent asked the Florida County is 41 million higher than what states require us to give to school system. It's 4.8 times this effort requirement, almost 5 times that. So how much is that? If we put that, try to ask the equivalent of county own budget, then you know the largest county own agency is its police department. So the 51.89 is basically half of the total police department's budget. Alternatively, if we say, okay, set aside police, that's our top priority, there's no desire to try to move money from police department there. So alternatively, 51.8 million is the equivalent of a total budget of 9 county agencies that include economic development authority, recreation, all recreation park service in the county, citizen services, service, all service in the county, social service, mental health, planning, zoning, inspection, license, permits, elections, and county executive office. So in other words, if we don't have the funding for that, and we have to look at agency cuts, that's basically equivalent to eliminating all those 9 agencies in total. If we say, if some people say, you know, how about if you, what does that mean for if you want to look at new revenues here? So just for illustration purpose, that 51.8 million is about raising 11.8 cents of new property tax. That's a 12% increase of county property tax, and that's equivalent of about $500 new real property tax per household in the county. So the second issue is how well does a county fund the school system compared to its peers? I hope it is readable. I mean, I didn't bring the handout this time. It was distributed in the prior meetings. At that point, we were not able to go over this information. But this chart is tell you, we look at FY 2016, the most recent budget, and we look at 8 biggest county in Maryland. Howard County general fund, 54% was contributed to the school system. Compared to all other counties, that's a higher. In the second place is Montgomery County, that's 52%, and then followed by Frederick. Baltimore City has the smallest this year, so only 16% of the general fund goes to the school system. We all know they got a lot of state aid on that. But this just tells you that actually, compared to our peers, we actually, in our own general fund, we contribute a lot this year to the school system. And that even hasn't included our contribution of the debt service to school CIP, our contribution to retiree health benefit to that. That's a county share on that there.
So in theory, if you have an additional $52 million, it would be up to close to 60%.
That's 59%, close to 60%. And so that's FY16. We also got some information from state DOS that provides a multi-year history. So if you look at the growth of the general fund contribution to the school system in the past several years, it looks like Howard County also are among the highest in public speed. This is this year 2010, and this is 2015, and under that is student enrollment growth. In those 6-year period of time, the only one beat us is Baltimore City, that increased by 18%, but we said that, you know, they have a very low base in the beginning. Howard County's contribution has increased by 14% in this period of time. Everybody else has less than 10% in the same period. If you look at the student enrollment, which is the second half of the chart, we actually was not the one that experienced the highest growth in this period. We're kind of right in the middle. But anyway, this just tell you that at least in the past several years, the county's contribution also has been increasing and higher than most of our peers in the counties. Here's another chart we got from the state DOS, and both the most recent data they have, that's just for 2015. This is about per pupil county funding to the school system there. Of the 24 counties here, the whole county, it was the second, have more than $10,000 per pupil. The only one was ahead of us is, how do you pronounce it?
Worcester.
Thank you. I was getting it wrong. Worcester. But Worcester only have like 6,000 of them, so it's probably.
No scale.
Yes. Yeah. But of all the counties here, we have basically among the highest in home of the county contribution per student. And in terms of the school budget, you know, school budget was funded by county contributions, state contributions, federal, and there are all sources there. So in terms of that year, we also are listed second highest, right after Worcester, among the 24 counties in terms of the total school budget, how much percentage come to the local funding on that. So I just want to give you a few kind of slides to for the context to say, no matter in the how well we fund in our own budget, how much we give to school, or per pupil contribution, or the growth in the past several years, or amount of school system, how much is coming from the county funding, we actually are among either the highest or among the highest among the county. We all know, like, you know, there's a lot of demand here, but we also know we all live with constraints in terms of funding availability and also have to balance all the needs of the communities there. So just want to give you a little bit historical or background information.
Thank you, Holly. Any questions for Holly? I think it just gives us some the context. We're not here, you got a tough job ahead of looking at this budget. We're not here. Anybody wants to have drinks, we can talk about that within the context.
Can I just explain a couple things?
Sure.
Okay, first off, we start looking at it today. So this is the superintendent's initial presentation to us, and then the school board will spend the next 2 weeks in work sessions on each section going through everything in order to get to where we are. I just want to point out a couple of things that are in there that make this year different than other years. One is that this is the first year where, in case you were on Mars or something, the state pushed back a half share on the pension funds for teachers over the last 5 years. Effective this year, only the base is included in MOE. Any increase has to come right off the top of the funding. It's not included in the base formula. So for us, that's about $6.3 million. The raise that was negotiated with teachers last year includes $12.7 million that increases the base that was not included in MOE. A potential increase of 2%, which is not included in the straight forward, is about 13%. The more people funding is based on the numbers we have set from the 30th of this year, not the students who will be coming in next year. We're experiencing, though our growth isn't the greatest over the last 5 years, it is the greatest over the last several years. And Baltimore City is actually declining. So when you're looking at some of these things, it's a little different. So we're expecting another 1,100 to 1,200 students next year. So there's 69.3 positions in this budget to cover new students and across the district. So I just wanted to give that.
They're saying it's about 20 million.
Yeah, there's, you know, there's the, and the MOE is, oh, and our fixed cost for the general fund for health and dental is $24.3 million of that. So those are costs that are already obligated based on the employment that we have. And we are the largest employer in the county, so we employ over 8,000 people. So I just wanted to provide some idea of how that breaks down on the larger scale.
Question, just a quick clarification here. So you were talking about all those items that are above what you call the base MOE, right?
Yeah, MOE is required by the state of all counties, and it is the per pupil expenditure exclusive of one-time costs per student that was given last year. So there's no inflation factor. It's a straight count on the state level. The governor has the option of including an inflation factor. And the legislature last year required that the governor fund the inflation factor, which previously was at his discretion or her. And the GCEI, which is the Geographic Cost of Education Index, which monies were withheld, which were anticipated last year and were never received. So that's another set of money that was anticipated that didn't come, so that had to be sort. So now,
like, I guess the question is, those numbers you talked about, are they included in this 51.8 billion MOE equivalent? Is that where you would find those numbers?
The additional numbers, some of them are in there because they would be, but I mean, this is an increase over last year.
But is this above and beyond? So we're trying
to figure out. Well, the pension is definitely above and beyond.
Right, so that's not going to be the 51.8.
No, it is. That's included in the increase.
Okay, now,
but some of these things are part of the MOE too. I mean, it's just that those contributed to, because we don't fund based on MOE and everything, we just have a total. So if you look at what the funding we could expect based on MOE, it would be X. When we look at everything else, it adds additional money.
The numbers you've talked about, whatever is county approves, that becomes the new MOE?
Yes. But there are some things that are not included in what you are.
Understood.
Ryan? Yeah, just, I mean, I'll note, because the maintenance leverage, I mean, you look at it like it's annuity, right? It's going to be built in. So if you do a net present value calculation with a 5% discount rate, it's about an $800 million increase to the taxpayer in the duration.
And the context, so, we're not here to get into the budget. Those of who run businesses have a variety of perspectives of how you deal with growth and cost.
Right.
My personal view, since I've served on the college board and pushed that for 12 years, education is a business. The product is learning. And that's what you measure, and that's what you equate what you're spending to a change in learning. And the issues within the county are moving the learning in diverse groups that aren't participating in the demographics that make it easy. Because a large part of Howard County, and I have kids that have grown up, a large part of Howard County is our success, is what we do, but it's also the demographics. It's like, if I'm a great coach, give me the players, I'll blow the whistle, I'll do pretty well. I can screw it up. That's possible, but I've got a pretty good base to start with.
Well, I do. Can I just say again, the demographics in the county have changed over the last 10 years, and so a 20% of our students now qualify for free and reduced meals. That's not a number that people necessarily understand in as prosperous a place as Howard County is. Increasingly, we have students from foreign countries who do not. Not only do they not speak English, they are not literate in their own native languages. They can speak, but they cannot read or write. And the funding that we are mandated to provide by the state for students who are under kindergarten age, the pre-kindergarten population, in Maryland, local education agencies have to serve students from birth to 21. So if you are diagnosed with special needs, you are required to get services, whether they're delivered in the school or not. And students who are in the schools, which is essentially 3 and 4 and some 5-year-olds, are not funded by the state on their per pupil funding level. They are not even counted in our enrollment. So our enrollment is actually artificially suppressed because they don't count them as full-time equivalents in the figures. Not for population of schools, nor for delivery funding. We only get the extra monies that are allocated to service groups, but not the base funding. And that only became mandated for 4-year-olds like 2 years ago. So some of this is a built-in thing of having things build up to a point where we were able to cover by making some cuts in utilities or in bus transportation or in something, but 85% of our budget is people.
I got it, and I'll just put it in context to me, this is me, not anything else, is that I'd be looking at, within those groups, what's their growth in terms of learning? Just what's the impact of what we're doing versus their
growth? We're number one in the state again. Can I at least put some good news out there? We were just named the first time.
That's great, and it's, I would expect, I'm just saying, to me, it's how are our transient students, how are our disadvantaged students, what is their, what are we doing, you know, I'm just saying this, if I was looking at pure business, what is the money we're spending, are we making an impact there? And with my daughter, who you could have put her in a closed room and she would have, she was adopted, so I had no credit.
So we're not going to argue teachers.
I'll be on Steve's side with you.
No, I'm just saying, that's my, from an investor standpoint, that's what I think.
Just clarification, are we saying that the entire $52 million will be ongoing costs? Not, there's no one-time cost in here, all of this is ongoing costs?
It depends, some of it depends on how negotiations go. If there are things that are excluded, if they, you know, based on, but we now have a public school labor relation board, which requires binding arbitration. So if we cannot reach agreement, then that will be relayed to us, and we will have to find a way to make that adjustment. It is a unique situation compared to some other industries, and that's something where we used to be able to have the option. We no longer are, and they are still on, and they want more than that.
So, okay, we're off to a rousing start in terms of.
So now I'm.
Dr. Clinch, you're the star today. Dr. Clinch does a terrific job, and what he's going to let us lay out is the overall metrics of the economy and where he sees it in Maryland and the impact on us relative to revenue.
Bad news that we need more money to, I guess, moderate news that the economy is doing okay, but not great. Holly cut me back, so I'm going to go really fast. I must have bored the pants off you guys last year, so Holly cut me back.
The news wasn't good enough.
Yeah. It won't better.
And for those of you who've been on the committee for a while, I've gone from being the pessimist in the room to maybe being more optimistic than most in the room, which is very atypical for me. But today, I'm going to start with the national outlook, go to the Maryland outlook, which will be very brief, then go into how the county is doing. The national outlook, where are we? It's volatile. I mean, I don't need to tell you guys this. We had solid but underwhelming growth in 2015. Now, employment, which is the blue line here, has finally, and indexed to here, is finally above pre-recession levels. Unemployment nationally is finally dropping to 5%, which is the magic number. When you get under 5%, that's when you start seeing wage growth. But the labor market isn't fully healthy. There, you know, these are the unemployed, which as you can see are falling, but they're all what are called marginally attached and involuntary part-time workers, which are not falling quite as much. So that's one of the reasons we haven't seen this increase in wages, is because these workers who are marginally attached are people who, you know, work less hours than they want to work, involuntary part-time people, or people who work less than full-time because of economic, they can't find a full-time job. So, you know, but there is good news here in terms of the opportunities. We have low inflation nationally, which is going to lead to economic growth and investment. Low energy prices is pumping money into the national economy. But the challenge is this issue, as we've all read about, is this is the wage growthless recovery. But we're finally going to start seeing wage growth, I think, coming forward nationally. Threats abound out there. Europe is slow growth. Germany and Czechoslovakia are about the only two places in Europe growing right now. The Latin countries tend to be mired in recession right now. Asia, China is slowing, as we all know, and that is why we're all much poorer than we were last year in the stock market.
Can I ask, when you see the wage growth, you said we should start seeing it from your perspective. I know it's not a dot on the screen, but when you...
Moody's is predicting 20, you know, this year, by midpoint this year, halfway through this year, Moody's is predicting that we're going to be at the point where the labor market is going to start seeing wage growth. geographically, the recovery, as you can see, is spreading, but so red and yellow are the areas. Yellow is warning, red is bad. But again, these are either small states or energy-dependent states that were doing great while we were sucking wind, so you know, we're all glad they're doing bad now. The probability of a double-dip recession, what's the probability of entering a recession? You know, it ended this year, or last year, above where it started last year, but that's, you know, because we have stock market turmoil. You know, it's much lower than it was in the last 2 years, generally speaking. So nobody's really predicting another recession, barring, you know, something strange going on. But the big problem is real GDP has been volatile. You know, we went from very slow growth in the first quarter to high growth to growth to slow growth again. GDP growth has been very volatile. There's no other way to put it. My gut tells me that this is the preliminary number that was just released just after I made my PowerPoint, so I was really mad. So I had to go and redo it. And I think this is the first cut. There are three cuts of GDP forecast. This is going to be revised upward. I'll bet the donuts for the first meeting next year if you invite me back. But anyway, with the exception of the first quarter of 2014, we've had 18 quarters of positive economic growth. We are in a slow, steady, but unimpressive recovery nationally. Any questions about Nation? Going to Maryland, I'm going to do very little here because this is, you've all heard this last year and it's all in the report, which you're going to get. But Maryland is in the midst of the biggest economic transformation it's probably had in the last 30 years. The federal government is going from a driver of economic growth to a drag on the economy. Now, federal spending cushioned us from the last two recessions. The 2001 recession barely happened in the I-95 corridor. The last recession was, terrible, and but compared to the rest of the world, compared to Detroit, everywhere else, we didn't do that bad. But you have to go back to 1991, 1992 to have a comparable time in Maryland. That's when the Cold War was ending. The government was starting to talk serious about balancing the budget, and we had a pretty bad recession back then. But then the government started, spending more and more and more. And I was hired to come to Maryland then to write a report about how to convert the Maryland economy from defense and government spending. During that time, it increased by about 50%. So I didn't need my report in order to listen to it.
Tech boom had nothing to do with that, right?
The good news, the federal government can't move. It can't pick up and go to Mexico to start, doing stuff. So what this means is the federal government has been not only employing people who get the highest wages on average of any employment sector in the state and the country, it had been a growing base, and they've been spending more. They can't move, so we're not Detroit. But the thing is, they're not going to grow. So what we really have to do is diversify the Maryland economy. We have to build on the assets we have to diversify the economy and really address business climate issues. Again, this is just how reliant are we on federal spending. It's in the report, not surprising. When you look at federal employment by place of work, jobs in the border of Maryland, 220,000 jobs, 6.3% of employment, fifth highest in the country in both measures. Lots of people in Maryland drive to D.C., go to other places to work for the federal government. So when you look at the share of jobs, 300,000 Marylanders work for the federal government, 10%, second and third highest concentration. Federal procurement, the federal government spends $28.1 billion in Maryland in 2014, $4,700 per capita, the highest concentration. This decline in growth in employment and spending is what dragged the Maryland economy down, and that's what's going to keep it down going forward.
So what you're saying is, and I guess you'll get to it, is we need to grow our other business sectors, or we're going to be...
Very good. This is you either read the slides or you think alike. Future growth is going to depend on the national recovery continuing, which I think it's going to do, despite the fact that the stock market is doing quite badly right now. What Maryland has to do is redeploy its substantial economic development assets from federal to private sector markets. In the 1990s, we called this defense conversion. In doing so, Maryland as a state has a lot to build on. We're in the top five states in terms of skilled and educated workforce. We have hospitals and educational institutions that are driving economic growth across the I-95 corridor, from Montgomery, from Washington, up to Baltimore. We have a huge federal university R&D base. that are generating the technologies and leading and supporting the tech boom here in Maryland. We are the, depending on which measure you want to do, fourth, fifth, or sixth largest state in terms of life sciences, which is probably the major national growth sector. We have a strong base of other technology businesses, cyber, IT, those types of things. But again, the drag on us is Maryland's business climate is seen as a substantial weakness in terms of attracting and retaining businesses. That's kind of my take on the state very quickly. Do you have any questions?
The same thing said of Virginia.
On business climate or dependence? Defense
same,
dependence.
Same profile, same type of profile.
With everything but Virginia.
Maryland's business climate is seen as a weakness.
I would say Virginia has every one of these problems except a larger and more diversified economy. It's a bigger state. I mean, that's got a lot to do with it. They're not seen as a business climate. I had to do a white paper for a major development project in Baltimore. I think 8 of the last 11 major economic development projects that we lost to Virginia, we lost them on the basis of incentives and business climate. So yes, every one of these top things applies to Virginia.
Head to head, they're perceived as a stronger business. A stronger business climate in Virginia than Maryland.
I think people would say that.
But overall, we're pretty much.
Except for the fact they have a larger and more diversified economy. So, you know, they do have, you know, the Southern Virginia, Western Virginia, that are better. They have scale.
Okay.
So the level of dependence is roughly equal on a per capita. In Northern Virginia, is more concentrated. Sure. Yeah. So.
Thank
you. Howard County, where are we positioned in this? Howard County has substantial assets. Location. We're between two major metropolitan area markets. Both of those markets are growing now. It used to be that Washington was the growth pole, but Baltimore is doing quite now, well now. So we are located between these two growing metropolitan area markets. As I'm going to show you in a minute, we have a growth of a substantially highly educated, high-income resident base. We are an emerging center for employment growth here within the county. We're no longer just a bedroom community sending people north and south. We have substantial employment growth in the county. But there are warning signs in terms of a slowdown in economic growth. Howard County is gaining people and jobs. When you look at total population growth, you know, since 2001, so we have 14, 15 years, total employment growth. We were fourth in population growth. We were, I think, second in total employment growth and first in private sector employment growth over the long term. So we have long-term growth benefits both in jobs and people occurring here in the county. One of the interesting things is we are gaining population from both domestic and international migration. When you look at the region as a whole, lots of international residents coming into the region, but Baltimore as a region is losing population to other jurisdictions outside of Maryland, outside of the region. Howard County and Anne Arundel are only the only two counties in the metropolitan area getting both domestic migration from other parts of the state and region and international growth. So we're in, what does that mean? Why is it important? We're an attractive location for people to move to. One warning sign, unlike in the last reports where we had the people who are moving into the state and the people moving out of the state, people moving into the county had higher incomes than the people moving out of the county. For the last 2 years of which data available, we're losing higher income residents to other places. I think what's really happening here is people didn't retire. These are, generally speaking, probably retirees who are probably, you know, didn't defer your retirement until the economy got better. But this is something that is a worrying sign if it continues. Aging in place.
Well, but I guess another question on that, how much of that also, I guess, particularly maybe on the in, I guess the in-migration piece ties in also perhaps on some of the comments as an example relative to the school system and the increase of I guess lower socioeconomic students and
migrants actually have higher incomes than county residents, so okay. It actually is increasing, but again we're getting a more mixed bag. Yeah, I think who's moving into the county, why are you moving here? I would imagine we're attracting younger families attracted here because of the school system, the quality of life, the location. You know, people like my family split between Washington and Baltimore. Why do we live in Howard County? That's one of the reasons. Plus the schools, plus the quality of life, plus Columbia. And who's leaving? It's going to be, you know, older people who have higher incomes. This isn't earth-shattering. It's just this change, this transition bothers me. It's something that you look at.
Part of it is probably, it's the maturation of the county.
Right.
It's the maturation of Columbia within the county, which was the largest group, so what you, it's not, you're right, it shouldn't be surprising, but it's reality that.
That this is happening.
There was a study done by the state of Maryland about 10 years ago on elderly migration in Maryland, and in Howard County, the in-migration is tending, or was at that point, tending to come from Prince George's County, and they tended to be higher income. So I throw that in because why people move here, I'd say from 50s on up, has to do with features that are not necessarily related to the school system when we look at overdose.
We'll also be interested to see if you saw this number for neighboring counties to our, I guess we'll call it more like, say, a Carroll, where you have a lot of big houses out there, people might be.
I haven't run for Carroll.
I'd be interested to see.
Baltimore City looks the same, Baltimore County looks the same, Prince George's County looks worse.
Right.
And I can't remember the Montgomery number, it's just.
I can tell you that Carroll County is losing school age population.
Right.
And they're closing schools.
Right, I'm thinking just like maybe people who don't have kids, more affluent, maybe pushing out of Howard to get more land with their big old house.
And the farm thing, so it seems like that would indicate that you're concerned with farm frigorous meals and that they look
connected. Yeah, I didn't really look at low-income migration. I kind of looked at broader than this and see if there's anything. I have not looked at that.
It'd be interesting relative to the lower income. If you stratify the
in migrant versus the.
It'd be interesting though because relative to what percentage of those would be driven by the school system and multifamily would be that's where they would.
Yes, where they live.
And so again, revenue versus expense.
Yeah.
Not right or wrong. It's just the reality.
Just wait, the reality. Low. Yeah. Townhouses, apartments generate less dollars per, I mean, per household than townhomes, than single family homes,
and more school,
and then they generally speaking, the apartments cost more, townhomes cost slightly less than more than single, and then single is lower.
And our yields from apartments are higher than they. It used to be that our primary yields were for townhouses or single family, but because what's now affordable, especially in the corridor along Route 1, and what's been built, we're seeing larger yields from apartment complexes and multifamily. So it's a shift.
And to put that in context, post-recession, the biggest boom in real estate is the multifamily because the change that took place when the collapse of the housing market, which was probably appropriate in some ways, but it's really, that's the only thing being built is multifamily. So it does have a change in terms of our influx, in terms of who's coming in terms of their what they're making and how many of their kids going to school.
Can you expand just a little bit on the international? We in our home building business, that's the explosion is the international.
I haven't looked at it who they are, but
how significant is it? Where are the county that's seeing influx of international and
all. Across the region, there's an influx in international. The reason I threw this one up, and I can talk to you after offline about the scale. But what's interesting is only two counties are getting both domestic. What's interesting to me is we're getting domestic in-migration, net positive.
Right, I understand. Does international mean their place of birth, or does that mean they actually moved into the area? In other words, if they are of foreign descent and just moved here,
a mix of foreign immigration and people who are not citizens moving from other jurisdictions within.
But if the U.S. citizens and there are foreign descent, that doesn't count. That
no. No. If you're a U.S. citizen, that wouldn't count. The county has substantial economic workforce assets. Seventh highest income in the nation, highest income in Maryland. 72% of the labor force is employed, or is in 70%, 2% of working age population is in the workforce, 68% employed, higher than the region, higher than the state, higher than the Washington region, among the highest level of education in this city, state, region, metro area. 60% of workers have a bachelor's or above, Maryland's only 38%. We're a professional workforce, 59% of workers are employed in management, business, science, and arts occupations, compared to Maryland at 45%. We are again straddling these two growing areas. We're sending about as many people to Washington as we are to the remaining Baltimore metropolitan area. So again, tying to location being one of our chief attributes. So I guess when you look at employment, there's two stories here: long-term success, near-term challenges. When you look at total employment, we've grown much more. This is just indexed to 100, with 2,000 being the base. We're significantly outgrowing the state, the nation, but things have kind of leveled off.
Actually, one stop on that, right, a little bit.
Sure.
On that here. The 2013.
I was going to get to that in the next slide.
Not the different factors.
Okay.
But the total. The 2013-2014, actually, I believe the job growth for the county at 0.3%, the state average at 0.8%. So for the last 2 years, job growth of the county, or they lack behind
in total. And in private, we matched the state, so 2.1.
And I think the one was not shown here in the slide, but in your report, which you were looking later to the group there. We have a few slides comparing the county and Maryland and the national. I think with the exception of unemployment rate, we're still doing better than everybody. Personal income growth and
the job growth there,
we both lag behind the nation. For the past few years.
Two years for employment, 3 years for personal income.
And this one indicator also lag behind the state average.
As you look at that, and maybe comment on it, is there any linkage between that and the fact that we built out? So
I think that might be one of the problems we're having, is the built environment. Again, where is the growth? It's in professional services, i.e. government contracting, and corporate facilities, so this is management of enterprises. So we've had, much more rapid, but again, this peaked in 2012 and had and fallen by about 2,000 jobs or so. Show management of companies grew even more, so this is like corporate headquarters, back office operations. They've peaked in 2011 and have fallen somewhat since then. So again, you have long-term success, near-term challenges.
And that's worrisome because professional service, technology, business services, these are the high-paid, high-end jobs, and historically has been very well in the county.
In the county.
So we are kind of concerned about that part of since to be shrinking, at least in short term.
So, this isn't in the report, and it's kind of hard to read, I know that, but these are the main sectors of the economy, and again, it's just trying to put a number to the growth. So what you've seen is this much rapid growth in professional services, management, education, health, but in the last 2 years, these have really fallen in employment. Now, I think there's a couple things that can be going on here. Government contracting, which I'm going to get to. Changes in NAICS code. Businesses could have been reclassified. When you see 1,000 loss over here and 1,000 gain in administration, you kind of wonder if that's a reclass of an employment. So there could be what are called non-economic changes going on here. We have no way of knowing it. But again, I'm worried because recent employment growth is lagging. I think Larry talked about this 2 weeks ago. One of the reasons that's contributing to that is lack of space. We don't have the built environment, real estate availability. We haven't had, and in the report I talked about decline in permitting activity, which in your report picked back up in 2015, if I correctly, non-residential permitting, right? So fell substantially in 2014, but has picked up in 2015 with partial data, which I didn't have access to the partial data.
Absolutely.
So,
what's the reason? Where do you see that coming from?
I mean, a lot of that sounds out.
So our opportunity in the short, some of the long run, is downtown to the extent we're building non-retail. So as long as we're doing vertical offices, that's where our opportunity is.
And one of the things in the report that I talked about last year, we are relatively underserved in retail and leisure and hospitality services as a county. There is room to grow these jobs, but these aren't, as Holly talked about, if you had to pick a job that you wanted to bring into the county, that's not it from an economic development standpoint. We need to have a balanced economy. I'm not saying they're bad jobs. I'm simply saying professional services jobs pay better. Why did things get worse? When you look at federal procurement, We've had tremendous growth over the last decade and a half, but it's really kind of been trending down, except for a pickup in 2014. But a lot of this is construction. It didn't actually occur in the county. The contractor was here. So we really have a general trend downward in procurement. So this is what's probably driving the poor performance of the contracting, business and professional services sector. Why am I not completely and utterly panicked about this? Because when you look at what the county does in terms of federal procurement, it's overwhelmingly these professional services. So about 70 cents of every federal procurement dollar spent in the county is in this. About 50% of it is in R&D. And just I want to point out, these are preliminary numbers for 2015, so they're not final. They're going to be up. We might do this at the end of the year because there's a lag in reporting. These will be higher. And also, NSA CIA purchases aren't in here. And when you look at the contractors, APL, about half of the contractor base. So I'm going to go to my forecast and go into what I'm thinking in terms of personal income growth is, you know, we've had, you know, very low growth in 2013, you know, good growth in 2012. I think for 2014, we saw from actual numbers about 4% growth. 2015, I'm predicting 4.4%, then going up to, you know, the fives. Now, Holly and I argued a lot about this, so, but I want to say we're kind of regressing. It's hard to predict personal income in the county because it's very variable. So what this is the actual growth in the county, and then these are my projections, and this is the kind of last 14-year average. So what you're seeing is in the early part of this recovery, we did well. Part of that was driven by our contractor base, people moving in with the county. But a part of that was driven by the fact that in recoveries, wealthier people, and we're the seventh most wealthy county in the nation, largest, most wealthy in Maryland, do better. So now that the national economy is projected to start really improving, I'm not predicting that we have these, you know, much higher rates of success, but are kind of going to stick with the long-term mean for projections.
Can I ask you a question? Sure. Two things. How much of the personal income growth each year you look at is capital gains tied?
You can't figure it out. The way personal income is
judged,
it's small. It's a small piece. That is kind of typically, it's the icing on the cake. I think it contributes to these in these years, and it's lagged. So the stock market started turning around, you know, from the 2001 around here. The capital gains were realized here. You know, I think we're going to probably have a capital gains surprise next year, and then 2 years from now, it's going to be abysmal. Probably 2, 3, 4 years now. But the way to think of capital gains is icing on the personal income growth cake. So why am I positive here? Again, after 5 years of being on the committee and being negative and having these low numbers, the national recovery is expected to gain strength. I think, you know, we are in an adjustment that is, you know, animal spirits driven, not economically driven, nationally, internationally. I think the global economy is going to start. Europe is going to start doing better. China, everything's crashing in China. They're growing at 5%. I mean, that's not a bad thing. Maryland's recovery is gaining momentum. The federal budget is stabilizing. Everybody thinks the federal government's going to be less of a drag than it has been in the last 3 or 4 years. And there are these opportunities for growth and diversification of the state and regional economy. So again, I'm not predicting boom years like we had in the early part of the recovery from 2000, but kind of normal rates of growth.
So you had some personal services trends that you'd shown prior.
The big ones or the little ones?
Well, I guess my big question is, when you showed the largest contractors list, you noted that they weren't, might be spending money not on budgets. And I'm curious if that's in your professional services.
Yeah, I would imagine, what isn't in the, this is all data what's called the Federal Procurement Data System. What isn't in the Federal Procurement Data System is cyber.
I got it. So my question comes, if your professional services numbers are trending in a particular direction.
They should be in the.
Is that reported by NAICS code or is that reported by the government? In other words, are you getting the data from the companies or are you getting the data from the government? That, forget that. What I'm asking is, if we're growing in the national security space, would we know it in your numbers?
We would not know it from the spending numbers, but those jobs would show up in what's called the QCEW.
And you would have that in here when you see.
And that would be in these numbers.
That's what I'm asking.
Now, there are some dark companies that are in the way here.
Dark.
But they're not here. They're on base, and they're not.
They don't keep their lights.
They're not affected by any questions about anyone.
They are.
Continuing to grow. On income?
Yeah.
I haven't studied it. I would imagine Howard County is overwhelmingly positive. I would imagine for the Baltimore metropolitan region it's mixed. I would imagine for the city it's negative. That's really based on
observations,
not hard facts. Who is the international migration to Howard County? Yes, in Route 1 we're attracting a different people than we are in Glenelg. But the people moving in... It's me, I should have said that. But who are the international migrations? Asians, East Asians, professional services. I think, again, if you looked at Baltimore County, you'd see a different number, Baltimore City, a different number. You know, we're very close to Montgomery County in this, except, you know, they have an inner beltway area. Other questions? I'm sorry, Holly, I went long.
You did great.
Thank you.
My timer, yes.
Actually, this is going to work out well. A lot of the points that Richard made and a lot of the questions that came up, I kind of went over too. So hopefully this will clarify things and maybe add to the previous discussions and questions. So Holly asked me to talk about these three topics, change in demographics. In particular, we're going to focus a lot on the aging population, as this is relevant to this group, looking at economic freedom forward, how it impacts the county tax base. Land use a bit on historical and so what a bit on where we were and a lot more where we're going to go in terms of the built environment, and then a little bit on the current development, what's actually being planned for right now in the county. So first, a bit about the population. This is between the 2000 and 2010 census. So we grew by about 35,000 people from 2000 to 2010. That's a 16% increase. So the population increased to about 287,000 people in 2010. And if you look at the increase in diversity that was touched upon, the greatest growth were for Asians and Pacific Islanders. So of the 30,000 gross increase, 22,000 of that was the Asian population. And then the next highest was African American. They grew by 39%, total increase of 13,000. And then Hispanic was the next highest. And the non-white Hispanic actually grew in Howard County. So that really shows, exemplifies the increasing diversity of Howard County. That's the first time that's happened between two decennial censuses. So if you look at the 80 and 90 and 70 and 80, that's the first time that's happened. The county is clearly becoming more diverse as we report. This is more recent data, and it's from 2010 to 2014. And you can see, again, the increase in the population increased by 7.7% in those 4 years, about 22,000 more people were added in Howard County. And you can see that the diversity continues in Howard County with that growth. If you look at the non-Hispanic white, last year there was actually a decrease, so those trends continued, but the first 3 years after 2010 there was an actual increase. So you can kind of see that the non-Hispanic white population is also increasing. Howard County is not unique. This is just a map showing Howard County and all of the other counties. This shows the percent minority share. So the darker the color, the greater percentage of minority. So Howard County, you can see that, is 44.6% minority in 2014. It's expected by 2020 will be a majority minority county. Montgomery, PG, Charles, Baltimore City are already at that 50% level. Howard County will be there shortly. The school system, I think 2 years ago or last year, was it last year? 2 years ago, was already at that. So the majority of the children are minority populations. And if you look at this, there's, I don't have the chart, but if you look at that by age, I think around 40 years old or so is when you have that break. In other words, a lot of the young population in Howard County that is minority compared to the older population, which makes sense as you have immigration and all those trends continue. So this is kind of a history of Howard County growth over time. 2010 census was the last census that was taken, 207,000 people. The red is the projected growth in Howard County. So that's looking at our land use patterns and what we expect as we have new construction over time, how many residents will be added to this campus. The county is continuing to grow, but it's projected to kind of slow down over time. It's going to slow down as the land use, if you run out of land. This is based on current zoning, actually. So we could always rezone and change things, but based on the current general plan, which was adopted about 2 years ago, this is our expected population growth. So let's talk a bit about the aging of the population. As we all know, the older population is projected to increase, and this is at the national level. It's going to double from 43 million in 2012 to 84 million in 2050. 2012 was right around the time of the first leading edge of the baby boomers are starting to retire. So baby boomers are those born between 1946 and 1964.
And within that context, we've got 300 billion people in the country now.
Something like that.
What are we projecting by 2050?
2050? I don't know. Oh, total population?
Yeah.
I don't know. The nation grows about 1% per year. So I'm not sure what the total national population. I think 65 plus is going to be about 20% of the population in 2030. I mean, I have more slides than that, so you can see that. That's what it says in the next bullet. So by 2030, 1 in 5 Americans will be 65 years old. Growth in the older population will be driven by the baby boomers, which I just mentioned the next few slides. And this is a really interesting chart. I got this from the Census Bureau. So this looks at the history of the population age 65 plus from 1900 to 2050. And this was your question. So you can see that the baby boomer crest, so the baby boomer wave will start right here. So starting about 2010, we're going to have unprecedented growth over the next 20 years. So between 2010 and 2030, we're about a quarter of the way through that, but right in the middle of that, we're going to have this huge growth, and it's going to kind of level off over time as the baby boomers start So this is a good chart here.
Thank you.
This kind of shows you that pictorially. So at 65, you can see the baby boomers, a bunch of them, and then in 2012, where we are about now, you can see where that is, and then by 2030 and then 2060.
It's pushed out.
One thing that's important to note is a lot of people don't realize that the millennials, so there's the baby boomers and then there's Gen X, which is a smaller group, and then there's the millennials, which are basically the children of the baby boomers for the most part. The millennial population currently is actually bigger than the baby boomers. So that is an important point, and the U.S. is pretty fortunate to have that situation.
It's good for the economy.
It's good for the economy, exactly, yeah. And if you look at other countries, a lot of countries in Europe, Northern Europe in particular, Japan, even China, is still moving forward because of the one-child policy. They don't have that situation. They don't have that base supporting their right.
And I remember in the 80s going to a demographer, economist, talked about where he saw the economy going. It was all based on where you got in terms of your life and what your disposable income was in that versus not disposable, and that would drive the economy, and it's absolutely
right. Yeah, and it's also the whole concept of the social security, right? How many workers are in the social security? But in large part, we have that situation compared to many developed countries because we have a robust immigration system and relatively high birth rate relative to other countries, you know, in Northern Europe, Japan, and other Asian countries, China, etc. So Howard County, in specifically though, this is where projections for Howard County. So in 2010, I already talked about the overall numbers, but in 2010, those 65 plus were about 10% of the population. And it's expected, similar to the nation, it's expected to double to 20%. So by the next 20 years, that's a big way to move through. Now what these projections come from, I put together land use projections for housing units, and then I tie people to those housing units. And so I project, tied to the general plan, the next 20 years predicted population.
The 2030, flip back to where you had the national one, and I just want to get my hands around that, where you showed that.
This one?
Yeah, you said in 2030, it was a quarter, 25%. So I'm just saying in context, we would be lower than that 25% if everything else could be.
Well, that 25% is really the point to show the thing. We're a quarter of the way through the increase. I think it's 20% also.
It's 20.
It was that previous slide.
Oh, it is 20.
It was that bullet point. Yeah.
It is 20.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So it's the same. Now, the way these projections come from, I do the overall population projections, and the Maryland Department of Planning has a cohort model. So I give this information to them. They feed that into their cohort model. So they know the age structure currently in the county, and they kind of project that forward. So just an estimate. It's very difficult, and I'll talk a little bit later about that when I show projections of school-age kids from the school system, which I have. But, and I'll talk about that a bit right here. So the 5 to 19 population, according to this cohort model, is expected to increase by only about 4,000, right, over that 22-decade period. And so, but lately the school system has been growing faster than that. And I'll show some numbers. So the question is, what's really going to happen? I mean, so there's the whole question of aging in place. Are people in Howard County aging in place, or are they moving out and then older neighborhoods recycling with new families moving in because of the quality of the school system? Is the increase in the Howard County population, school population, is that kind of a short-term thing? Is that increasing relatively rapidly now, or is that going to kind of taper off in the over 2 decades, is that reasonable or not? So these are the kinds of questions that are basically unknown and we need to think about. Regarding aging in place, I think Phyllis referred to the study 10 years ago. Most people do age in place. That study kind of confirmed most people do want to stay where they live. The study did show that there's a segment of the population that do move in place, like Florida or Arizona. And it's the relatively young retirees that do choose to move. And it's a small portion of those in the county. Most people do prefer to age in place. But the study also showed that there's the older population tend to want to move back to where they were from originally for the children to take care of. So you have this kind of dynamic. So I think in general most people are going to age in place. So the question is how does that impact schools and what's the future of the schools? Given the attractive school system, are we going to still continue to have a lot of school age kids moving in?
Do you have any notion of how much of the county's income is based on federal benefits?
Federal benefits,
yeah.
Meaning like,
I'm thinking as that population swells, right? And
you mean like with Social Security?
Yeah, theoretically, I mean like, so how susceptible is our economy in a federal policy change on like retirement age, when people can retire, or what benefits are going to be, start limiting them? We're a wealthy county, so I assume most people aren't dependent on the federal income. I'm curious how much of the percentage and how much volatility is in there. If we're at the end of the whip of the federal government to say, you know, we're great as long as federal benefits are kept up, but when they fall off, we fall off.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know the answer to that, to your question. I think, just thinking through it, I think, you know, of course, Social Security people will get that. And given we have so many federal employees, that might be a good thing because of pensions. Most Americans don't have pensions these days. But given we have federal employees, so as people retire, if they are federal employees, relative to other places, they'll probably have a higher income than their retirees. So, you know, it's not, again, we're in good shape because of the location of Tarrant County.
Wouldn't our issue, though, be ultimately in terms of beyond this spending for a little down, downstream is relative to their, wages, they're still going to, whether it's federal or not, it's still going to be lower. They're going to have less money during the time. So less money, potentially less capital gains, and what does that impact the total pie of revenue?
Right. Yeah, so relatively speaking, if this happens, we will have less revenue.
Not just our revenue, we have two pieces of revenue.
Right. Yeah, although at the same time, with the working age population, you know, 20 to 44, those are also projected to increase. So we're still going to have growth in the working age populations.
Jeff, you know, like you would think with that millennial population that you talk about, you'd think the 20 to 24 or 45 would be growing. You know, we're, in other words, this projection seems to say we're not going to get our percentage of millennials.
Well, actually, they are pretty robust. So, you know, whereas those 65 plus grow 20%,
yeah,
the, you know, 20 to 44, this includes millennials and Gen X, so, you know, these are about 50% increase.
Well, but if you look, I'm just looking at raw numbers, 20 to 24.
Well, that's not percent increase, that's right.
That's
yeah,
92 to 113 is fairly modest.
Right, that's true, right. Yeah. That's a good point.
And 45 to 64 is flat.
Right, right.
I mean, well, yeah, I know you're using a cohort model.
Well, that's all Gen X, because the leading edge of the Gen Xers just turns, the first year turns 65 in 2030.
Right.
So that's the rest of Gen X.
So millennials by 2030, these mighty millennials, 45.
Yeah.
Maybe you're getting to it later on in the presentation, but looking at housing choices and existing housing stock, I've seen a lot of polls where millennials want to be in walkable downtown urban areas.
Yeah.
And then you see what's happening in Carroll County, where there's, you know, 10-acre lots and they're closing down schools because there's not enough young families. So are you projecting what sort of housing mix we're going to need for our growing older population that doesn't want to have a 5-acre lot, and attracting millennials who also don't want to have 5-acre lots?
Yeah, so that actually we'll be talking about that.
Okay.
So the next section is land use, so we'll get into that for sure. You mentioned what millennials like. I heard millennials like BMWs, biking, walking, and walkability, or biking, mass transit, walkability. Yeah.
One of the minor upsides of an aging population, if they have IRAs and 401ks, is required minimum distribution.
Yes.
And a lot of the money today is hidden behind retirement accounts, not creating capital gains currently. That'll be turned on when they're forced to at 70, beyond 59.5 to 70.5. So lack of Social Security or lack of other funds will be somewhat modified by forced distribution, whether you're employed or not, will come out.
Yeah. That would be interesting to look at if it's possible to find out how much
it's coming.
How much people in Howard County, what's the assets of people?
Well, we're seeing it on our asset base where we have forced R&Ds. That's a distribution that we don't want. People don't need it, but they have to take it.
That's called designated charity. Hopefully.
Yeah. One man's charity is another man's loss.
So this is just a chart that shows the same thing. You can kind of see the growth in the various age groups. It also includes some higher ages, 75 to 84, 85 plus. So one thing that needs to be thought about in our county is the social services, or how to address the aging of the population. Those 75 to 84 can increase almost 200% in 30 years. And those that are 85 plus, percentage of life at the pace of growth. So that's a big increase in population relative to what we're used to today. This is that chart I mentioned. It's the school enrollment starting from 1973. and you can see the percentage growth. I just included the whole thing because it's really nice to see the trends of what's happened over the last few decades. But the student population growth actually was quite large last year compared to the relative recent years. 1,100.
And Ellen, you're projecting the same?
They're projecting, essentially the same attendance. So we're looking at something in the order of 16,000 kids over the next.
So there's a clear difference between that, what the school system's projecting, and what the cohort model shows.
Right.
So it's a question, what's the dynamic driving that? And which is right?
Do you have a sense when you're looking at 1,600 here, where they're coming, relative to the diversity and demographics, where they're coming from relative to the issues of learning?
Well, sort of. I mean, the surviving cohort piece is, yes, we know in place, we have a first grader who becomes second grader.
Yeah.
Over this number of years, they will move, through the system unless something changes. The hardest thing to predict is what will happen in terms of
existing neighborhood.
Which is where our greatest growth actually comes from, not from new, okay? It comes from the fact that a neighborhood, no children have come out of that neighborhood in 18 years, and now the parents move into 50 plus housing or they move whatever they sell, and a family comes in, and there's literally no way to figure out where that's going to be and why it's going to be and how often it will happen.
That was our discussion last year on transfer tax.
Yeah, I mean, that's.
And it varies also.
And that's why the transfer tax applying not just to new homes, but applying to sales of existing property, as well as applying to sales of commercial and industrial property, and that everybody was sharing in that, and that had an impact on that
growth
and change.
1,100 new students, say in 15, and if I heard your earlier say, you need 70 teachers.
You need 69 teachers.
69 teachers. If you're looking at 1,100, student increases for the foreseeable future. Does that also mean that you're looking at 69 to 70 new teachers every year?
Well, no, probably not, because what happens is they don't, that's again, where are they coming?
Okay.
So I can take, when my class size increases by 3, I don't get a new teacher.
Okay.
When my class size increases by X, I need to get a new teacher. Is there actually room in that school
mm-hmm.
for a new classroom? Am I going to now have to redistribute where kids are in order to do that? So it's multiple, and it depends on where those instructors are needed. If I'm seeing growth in certain kinds of subjects, in terms of interest in subject areas, I think one of the things that might save us, sort of, is that we are having more success with some of our remote distance learning. So where I would have had trouble providing access at all 12 high schools to a differential equations class, okay, or to a particular foreign language, or to an advanced history or something like that. Now I can have a single teacher from a single point fill the need of a bunch. So I don't have to look at an increase of 3 people. Maybe I'm looking at 1.5 because I can make that work in a different way.
So
but that costs money in infrastructure support in order to make that work.
But still, what you're describing is more or less a refinement of how many new teachers you'll need.
Yeah.
Today, it's 69 new teachers for roughly 1,100 employees, I'm sorry, 1,100 students. Some larger number of teachers, maybe 35, maybe 40 new teachers a year to respond to that increase in the student population. Sure.
Probably. And then we're seeing retirements of around 200. So
that's just replacement of
that's replacement of existing ones.
Creation
and some
of new teaching positions. We're looking at 35 to 40 probably per year for the decision.
So we're gonna continue to grow in terms of our size of the institution.
Okay.
And then what support services are gonna be necessary for the growth in facilities, because we're the largest property holder and the largest number of buildings
mm-hmm.
and facilities in the county. And all of that has things that associated with it. I just want people to remember that we serve from birth to 21. People tend to think of that school population as five. Oh, and I forgot to tell you that in another year, kids have to stay at 18. Okay, so each year the requirement age to stay in school is increasing by a year. So what it's going to cost to keep kids in school who would have left at 16, it's a whole different model if you have to retain them. So what we would have been losing a little bit, because of that, not that I want to drop out or anything, but it's a natural thing. We now have it just pushing
we,
now. For,
we need to keep,
sorry.
We need to, no, no, no. We need to keep moving.
Yeah,
we've got to
look at the clock. Okay. And I'll be able to back up. And just to wrap up the aging part of it, this is a report that the Department of Citizen Services recently issued. I'm just, if you haven't read it, you could refer to it. The senior population is increasing, so the county hasn't been looking at that. So how do we address that moving forward? So the next topic, evolving land use patterns. We talked about built environment, where new people coming from. This chart shows the existing number of housing units in the Howard County, all housing unit type, 113,000 housing units in the county currently. And this shows what's being under construction or permitted. Permitted, that means it's under construction, 1%. Unbuilt means it's recorded lots, and so as soon as they get building permits, they can then start construction. These are subdivision plans that the Department of Planning and Zoning currently is reviewing, and once they're approved, then they'll be recorded and be able to move forward. And this is what's left based on the undeveloped land capacity based on current zoning. So all told, 143,000 households. That's based on the current build-out based on the general plan. Of course, rezoning is going to occur in the future. But we shouldn't count on continued growth, because the reality is land in Howard County is limited, obviously, and we're going to know.
Can't that single family be there?
That's all homes. And this breaks out. This breaks out okay. In different sites. So currently about half are single family detached, 22% townhomes, 24% apartments. Howard County actually has a pretty diverse housing stock for a suburban community, in large part because of Columbia. Now, Columbia started in the 60s, very diverse housing types in Columbia. The growth, though, is expected to be different. So this is what was alluded to recently. This is the county preparing for the millennials and the older adult population. Looks like we will be. This, in large part, isn't driven to accommodate that, quite frankly, just based on land use, what's left in the county.
So that's a lot of that's downtown.
A lot of that's downtown. In fact, the next slide I'll talk about that a bit. A lot of it's Route 1. Yeah, so the single-family detached lots zoning, there's just not a lot of room left for the normal, you know, the single-family detached homes, which is currently about half of the housing stock. This is building permits over the last 14 years or so. So you can see how many housing units are built in the year per year in the county. You can see the blue. So it used to be we would have a lot of the single family decreased over time, and it's expected to remain at about one-third moving forward, one-third of all homes built moving forward. We have an app, though, that basically limits how much we built in Howard County per year. So it's very good that we have that, because we project budget growth based on that. Generally, we're actually below the affluent numbers, given the market, given land availability. Probably we're averaging about, you know, between 1,500 and 2,000 housing units a year. We're going to see these spikes, because whenever a big apartment complex is built, you're going to have a big, you know, 1 year. So where is this going to occur? Downtown Columbia was mentioned. So there's a plan that was approved in 2010. And it's moving forward. You see construction happening there right now. So all total, it's about a 20 to 30 year plan for build out. It's expected to add about 5,500 units, 4.3 million square feet of office, 1.25 million square feet of retail, and a 640 room hotel.
A factor thing with the affordable housing thing that's going through, that'll take that, kick that up to about 7,000.
6,400. So that's going to be proposed. And then 900 units of affordable housing.
And if I recall, that typically wanted a higher percentage in the school system. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, we're not anticipating that much out of just 5, but when you add the other,
then
that'll change.
Yeah. That'll increase the students by the portion of amount.
Yeah.
Yeah, the next 900, the next 100. And we're looking at that with the school system to plan for future school needs in downtown Columbia. The other big part of the growth area in Howard County is the Route 1 corridor. We rezoned the Route 1 corridor back in actually 2000 general plan to these new zoning types, and expect a lot of new development along Route 1. That's happening now, actually. So between downtown Columbia and Route 1, it's about 50% of the expected growth in Howard County moving forward based on the current general plan. So that's where a lot of the growth. Two-thirds of it is going to be multifamily, townhouse, and apartments. One-third single-family detached. Countywide. This is a snapshot of land use currently in Howard County. So 35% of it is developed residential of all types, multifamily and single family. 16% is of the land use land area is commercial, industrial, government, non-res uses. 11.5% is undeveloped. So not much left, really, as far as land. Now, what this doesn't include is, for example, downtown Columbia. We technically consider that developed because it's done, right? So But we're building up, we're building it up, right? We're going to build them all, parking lots, and building the crescent and things like that. So a lot of the future growth will occur through redevelopment opportunities. And then the county's done a very good job of between open space and parkland and preservation easements, about 38% of the county has been preserved. All right, so we can move forward here. This is the same thing, this is showing it in a different format from 94 to 2014. And then I'm going to kind of skip through this. Richard touched on this. Job growth continues in Howard County. Job growth is slowing in Howard County, so we had a faster pace of job growth than we had currently and what we expect. Some history of job growth. Top years, you can see what the top years are. We had 1 year of growth, a decrease in the Great Recession that occurred recently. The land use map of Howard County. Everybody's interested, we had that on lock, yeah.
How will Gateway affect the projections? I mean, is that, if it was mixed use, it could be a fair amount.
Gateway is like another Columbia, so Gateway has a potential for a future growth hub in Howard County.
That would be redevelopment.
Redevelopment, exactly.
Yeah, requires some zoning.
And then zoning, yeah.
Jeff, can you do the projected the undeveloped? Do you do it for the maximum allowable by current zoning, or is it the average that you've seen, or a particular?
It's basically
like average FAR. And
it's average. Okay. Yeah. So the zoning may say one thing, but you can't. We look at average because if you have steep slopes and floodplains, then you can't. Same with farm rents.
Yeah.
Sure, so last topic, four more slides, like maybe 1 minute, and then I'm done. This shows, and we can send this to you by email. This is what's in the pipeline. So there's a lot of development that we're reviewing right now, 9,000 units DPZ is reviewing. And then this goes into the details of where those are. Columbia is a big one. The present property down there, mm-hmm. South of Meriwether, 2,300 units is built shortly, the next few years. Office space, it was mentioned that office space is actually, construction is increasing, and that actually has increased this year compared to last year. We have about 530,000 square feet in the site development plan process where we're doing the DPZ plans. And this is large buildings of more than 10,000 square feet. So there's development in Maple Lawn still, and you can see some other places as well. A lot of it is, a lot of the size is new schools and things that we're going as well. So that's it.
Thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
I'm actually going to sit here, and Jackie Scott, the deputy of the department, is going to move the slides forward. I'm going to sit here because I can actually read my notes if I sit here. To follow right on the heels of Jeff, Jeff is actually tracking through white papers for DPZ, the growth of the older adult population since 1995. And so he was an early asset to the Department of Citizen Services in helping us look at what's coming ahead. I also will make sure, Holly, that we send a link to every member of this committee through Holly on the report that Jeff mentioned. This is creating a friendly community. And there's two parts to it. I'm happy to send you the report itself if you give me your business card. All of it is online, but I bring the larger one along to let you know that there's a lot of data in the appendices, and it's a very expensive one to actually print, so I'm encouraging people to use a small report and draw down from online each of the appendices that you might be interested in. But we're happy to share this in the committee. What I was asked to talk about today, I'm going to change my presentation a little bit. So Jackie, I may say to you, move forward a couple, stay on this one for a bit, just depending on, so I can tag into some of the things that you've heard earlier. First of all, the Department of Citizen Services is a part of county government. And we traditionally say that it's the human service side of county government. That's actually not exactly true because, as the questions here point out, the ability to live in this community is related to housing, transportation, land use, services, self-preparation. So it's not all about what do we do for somebody else, it's how can they be self-sufficient in this community. And I'm not just talking about older adults, I'm talking in general. So the Department of Citizen Services has a budget of about $18 million in FY16. Total number of staff at this point? 140 staff. It currently consists of three designated offices, the Office on Aging, the Office of Children's Services, and Consumer Affairs. It is, in addition to those offices, it is the lead agency for ending homelessness in Howard County. It coordinates Americans with Disabilities rules and conforming to those in county government, as well as in consultation with private industry. It is responsible for select actions and emergencies like the snowstorm that we had recently and the flooding that hopefully we have averted this week. It is a funder of nonprofit communities, nonprofit organizations in Howard County through its Community Service Partnership Program. It administers the North Laurel Multi-Service Center. And what is not on any organizational chart, and actually I think where it's going to be better described in the new legislation, is that it has a key role in the human service network of nonprofits, not just from a funding perspective, but it has a key role in terms of financial sustainability, look at their impact on vulnerable people, and their response to emergency needs. And to put the nonprofit community in a little bit of context, and you can stay right where you were just with Aging, but I want to give a little bit of context. When we look at the role of the nonprofit community as an economic driver in Howard County, according to 2011 data from the Maryland Nonprofit Association, in Howard County in 2011, the nonprofits employed 8% of the county's workforce, which totaled 11,640 people. And again, in 2011, it contributed 9% of the total county wages for a total of $203 million. So I want to put nonprofits on the table here in front of this group, because when you look at the impact on people, where it's not just where the corporate offices are. Not to say corporate offices aren't really important in the for-profit community, but often nonprofits get viewed as, oh, that's kind of nice. But what are we really going to talk about here? Well, that's what I wanted to put on the agenda here. So population growth, I'm really not going to go over this. Jeff has done a terrific job. The department is significantly focused on the growth of the older adult population, particularly in our Office on Aging. We have partners in implementing this plan. One of those is Columbia Association. And I want to publicly admit we've been a little distracted by reorganization efforts. So, Milton, we are going to get back to you on this. And we've also been looking at, as Jeff pointed out, what's happening with the younger part of our population, because, as you now know, Department of Citizen Services has responsibility for services to some extent for both ends of the age group. I'd now like to move to some trends that we're seeing in terms of poverty. If we look from 2007 to 2013, the percent of households receiving food stamps, which is the bars, is the one before that. So if you look at the far right, the percent of households receiving food stamps has grown from 2% in 2007 to 5.2% in 2013. So more than double in, 6 years. I want to point that out because there's federal criteria for that. So that actually indicates the growth of demand, not just changes in regulations. The second piece that I want to point out is the far left, which is the percent of children under the age of 5 in poverty, which moved from 5.4% in 2007 to 7.9%. That's a very significant statistic because we know from early childhood studies that brain development in the first 4 years is very important. And poverty is not just an issue of I don't have the income, that also tends to reflect, I may not even know what's around, I may not have the assets, I'm focused on where is the rent coming from next month. And so the impact on an entire family, as indicated by that statistic, is one that I'd like to pull to your attention. There's another, the increase in poverty, again, on the next slide, and these slides are provided to you. For us, the one that drew our attention, these are, by the way, are from the Association of Community Services self-sufficiency indicator report in 2015. Again, we'll provide the link to you to that report. But if you look at families with children on the far right, so it says all families below the self-sufficiency standard, that's families with children, growing from 28% to 42%. When you look at the ripple effect of people who are below the level of self-sufficiency, that is part of what this community really wants to take a look at. We're very, very good at telling ourselves how good the community is, and it is. There's no doubt about that. We can also be very, very good at saying, this is us. This isn't them. This is us. And so this is a part of the community that...
Can you unpack that just a little bit? Mm-hmm. Just what's the rationale? And am I... What's the raw numbers on this, too? Do you have that? And I guess why there... Obviously, the recession has played a huge part of that, but the recovery hasn't... It seems like the recovery hasn't helped out at all.
It might be, too, Josh, and I can't parse this data out, and maybe the ACS report does, but I can't tell you the impact of migration.
But Josh, however, I assume part of it's where the recovery comes from, and whether it's touching the lower end as well.
Right, and let me tell you what self-sufficiency standards are, so you have an understanding of at least that part, which is not what you asked. I apologize.
No, I probably should ask that too, because I will.
So self-sufficiency is newer language in the human service network, and what it shifts us from is looking at specific indicators of how well someone is doing. Are they on food stamps? Are they requiring support for where they live? And specific indicators. The definition of self-sufficiency is that an individual or family can meet basic needs without assistance.
Is a family a household?
So there are three breakdowns of that. The first is for an individual to be self-sufficient in Howard County in 2015, they needed an income of $36,331 to live self-sufficiently without subsidy for that housing or without food stamps. And for the second grouping is a single head of household with two children of school age. That family unit needed $71,185 annual income to be self-sufficient. And then the third category is a couple with one child and an infant, and that is $90,133. So just on that one, you're looking at, well, what's the cost of child care? What's the cost of transportation? And I like the self-sufficiency standard because it gives us a broader look at how all elements of the community fit within the well-being of families.
So a more upper-income county has a higher self-sufficiency standard. So
yes.
Right.
Yes.
St. Mary's County might be.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, exactly.
Which is older than our county.
Right. And so these are, in some cases, they are employees of nonprofit organizations in Howard County that are below self-sufficiency, living right. without support.
Or a Howard County teacher with a young child.
Or a Howard County teacher with a young child, or workforce people that, when we talk about workforce housing, and when we talk about housing for people whose average annual income is below $30,000, then you're talking about even deeper categories of self-sufficiency. This is not to paint a bad picture. This is just the reality of...
Well, if anything, I would say that it changes the face of the picture.
Mm-hmm.
Because oftentimes, if you talk about whether it's low to moderate income, if you say self-sufficiency, whatever new buzzword I guess that's appropriate at the time, it's real easy to have a certain face associated with it. But when you start talking about, you know, I mean, just, you know, $71,000 salary, $90,000, I mean, that changes the face of, because you can easily put someone easily that all of us knows in that salary category, as opposed to perhaps someone in the $36,000 realm, which is going to shift your focus as to who's making that level of salary and maybe what it is that they actually do for them.
I think that's a really good way to describe it, because it also, in the earlier presentations about earlier impacts of the recession, in some cases changes in pension or changes in jobs impacted by the recession or the slow growth now, means that people who didn't have economic problems before now are in a situation where, yeah, they're needing a little bit of help to do that. So it's us. It's not anybody else, it's us.
And 42, just to make sure I'm reading this correctly, 40, this represents that 42% of the overall population is below the Howard County, below the self-sufficiency standard?
That is families with children. It doesn't say that, but that is families with children. When I went back to take a look at it, 42% are below the self-sufficiency.
Do you know what that standard is, just so I know?
Yes, for families with children,
71,185.
If the children are in school, it's 71,185. If the children are preschool, it's 90,133.
So one child looks like?
Two. The first one was single, that it has one.
It was.
Yeah, and the other one, 90 was a couple.
Right.
90 was a couple, yes. And again, I take you back to the Association of Community Services self-sufficiency index report, and we'll make sure you that you have that one. So what I'd like to move on to is very, very generally, I'm going to move past the older population right now, is in DCS, how are we doing this? So this chart shows the breakdown of the 18 million I mentioned earlier. You can see 60% is from the general fund, and the remaining 40% is broken almost evenly between what fees do we charge, when we charge for training in our Office of Children Services, you know, that's a program revenue fund, as well as, grants. So the purple slice of that pie is grants that we bring into the department, and the other part is program revenue, where we generate revenue. So that makes up another 40%. We can go to the next graph. That data just backs up what I just said. This is where it gets spent. Like Ellen mentioned earlier about the school system, the predominant expense that we have is salary and wages. That's the blue part. We have fixed costs, which are chargebacks from other county agencies for how we use them. Technology, for instance, is an example. And 6.7% is where else we spend it.
Yes.
Operation area. Right. Okay. So we are a very typical human service organization. Our expenses are heavy on the salary side of it. And what I'd like to move to now is Council Bill 12, which has to do with reorganization. Oh, sorry, did I miss that? I did miss that. Okay, last in terms of trends. We have a community service partnership program, which in FY16 had a little over $7 million to grant to nonprofits. So in operating funds, and it falls down into what's an operating grant, in other words, keeping the lights on, funding staff, to what are special initiatives, and so focusing on the operating grants. So out of $7 million in FY16, $5.3 million went toward operating grants to about 28 nonprofits. In FY17, the requests that have come in, and these are requests that just were delivered to our office Monday of this week, the asks at this point are $7.4 million. So the nonprofits that have submitted applications for CSP funding, the ask is $7.4 million. So we don't know yet the amount of funds that will be available for CSP but we already know that the asks have gone up. And one of the areas, and I briefly looked at this last night, CSP is one of the few funding sources in the community that will fund operating costs, not everything, but operating costs. A lot of philanthropies will fund special projects or special initiatives, but not operating costs. And the value of an operating funder is that it recognizes that a nonprofit needs to be financially secure, because it's not going to do you any good to have a great project when you can't afford to hire a CFO in your organization. So it may not seem like a big difference to you, but it is. Funders are now more focusing on self-sufficiency in terms of the grant, so that's why I wanted to introduce that earlier to you. And the other trend that we are certainly seeing is that the greater number of clients is putting a lot of pressure on nonprofits to maintain an increased level of services. And one of the things that I think is a factor for us in Howard County is that we need to diversify the kinds of organizations that are actually supporting nonprofit organizations. It can't just be county government, it can't just be local foundations, but the business community has a role here. And I couldn't pretend to tell you exactly what it is, nor would I at this point, but I want to put that on your radar screen, because this is as much an investment in our community as schools is an investment, or as roads or bridges are investments. So that's the last piece of trends. And then, Holly, let me take some guidance from you. I can go forward with the reorganization, probably about 3 or 4 minutes, or if there's anything else you would rather that I share with this committee.
If you can at a high level of reorganization.
Okay.
All right. Not your fault.
No. That's okay. So Council Bill 12, which comes from county administration and submitted to the county council, will be heard February 16th. There is a parallel bill, which is Council Bill 11, and that's the transfer of transportation from where it sits right now into planning and zoning, but I'm not addressing that. So Council Bill 12 is looking at the reorganization of the Department of Citizen Services and the Department of Housing and Community Development. Move to the next slide. A big change is that the Office of the Department of Housing and Community Development, that the proposal that is before the council is to take the Housing Commission, which represents the bulk of that current department, and move it out into a public housing authority. And that means that the remainder of the programs in housing, so that move would move 30 people out of a 38-person department. With me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if the council approves. So what you have up here is a transfer to the Department of Citizen Services from the housing department of these 8 programs. I'm not going to describe them, but these 8 programs, along with the revenue that supports those programs, and because the housing department is supported largely by transfer tax, 1/8 of the transfer tax supports these kinds of efforts within the current housing department. We are going to put these in an Office of Housing and Community Partnerships. So that's this slide here. This will be a new office, a fourth office in the Department of Citizen Services that will have housing programs. It will have community service partnerships, so that funding mechanism for nonprofits. It will have the continuum of care for reducing homelessness and administration of a multi-service center. We are working very collaboratively with housing to do this, again, pending the approval of the county council, and looking very thoughtfully, talking to housing advocates, looking very thoughtfully at how we move forward on a big change. And the value of the change as it begins to integrate housing organizationally into a department where there is a service side.
Which is the key to affordable housing.
Which is the key to affordable housing. And it's also that key to integration. When I said earlier, it's not just about your income. It's about your housing. It's about do you have access to transportation. So for many of the individuals affected by the housing programs, it puts them, they were already served by us. This just makes it organizational. And I think we have, in the future, greater strategic opportunities to make it better.
Thank you, Phyllis.
You've heard a lot of things today, and I want to just put them and get you out of here in two categories. One is we've got to make a decision on what we can afford to recommend, given the budget and the growth, what we can recommend in spending and capital budget. But the other things you heard today, somehow, and get it in the report, is there's a need, whether it be from education to community services, is to have a larger discussion within the county of who we are and what we're going to be. Because all these things cost, and there has to be a measure on what you're getting for what you're spending. So there, in my view, whether it's social services, education, whatever we do, we have to have metrics to see, are we moving the needle to be beneficial to both people and to the county? And that has to be part of any process. We can't just spend money. We have to spend money with purpose and with knowing that we're getting results that make an impact, and if we're not, we change, just like we do in any other thing. So I think part of what needs to be done in a deeper way with the county, not in the politics of the county, is discussion about, like Phil said, who we are, what are the issues, and how do we attack those issues, and what does it cost? Because that's part of the discussion as citizens, of getting that out there so people understand how we put it into context. When I say discussion, we're not going to talk about the rain tax, but the rain tax is the most misnomer thing within the state in terms of what that was for. And it pulled everybody off into a wrong direction, not just in Howard County, but within the state, of understanding what we're trying to do and how we're trying to do it. And we can talk about funding and how we do it. That's not, I don't care. It's the issue is we have issues we have to deal with. And understanding those and putting those into conversations within our community versus talking points is one of the things that we can bring value beyond making recommendations in terms of what we can spend and what we can borrow. Because in a larger context, that'll frame where we can go as a county. And you know, we've got to get beyond the place where we're talking at each other, not just in the county, but beyond that. And hopefully in our discussions, we can at least encourage the council and the county executive and the community to start having those discussions in a more open and frequent way. So that's what I sort of heard today, and whether it's on school and how, you know, where the numbers are and how do you get learning from it, or the tremendous needs in terms of people within the county. We're a changing county. And I think sometimes we don't think where we were in this pristine sort of Columbia and Howard County with high revenue and high income. We still have that. So we look at $71,000 being non-sustainable, or $90,000 being non-sustainable. And I got to get my head around the context of that. And what does that mean in terms, because it isn't just about, this isn't about giving people money or giving people things. It's about how do we, where are we getting our money, and how do we move those, whether it's people. Now, I just remember I was told the story at my Rotary Club, and I'll end with this. It was 20 years ago. I went around the different Rotary Clubs and raised, I think we raised $5,000 to help a woman, and I don't know how I came to know about this woman, who was in Section 8 housing, and she had a disability, and if we could get her a van retrofitted so she could travel, she could get a job, and it took her off the taxi. And that was an investment that we made, and that impacted people. But we knew what the impact was, we knew what the result was, and I think that's in the context of talking about things. It's not about being a do-gooder, it's about being doing good that has real impact that we can see and measure relative to where we're spending money, because then it's easier for people to just say we should spend the money versus not knowing what the outcome is or know what the expected outcome is. So next week, the 11th?
Yes, 11th.
Okay.
Same time.
I'm getting worse. we'll try to get Saturday at 9 o'clock next week. And thank you very much for your patience.
Good job. Good.